So, hello everyone, and welcome to the latest episode of SRG World webinars, bringing you the latest in automotive research, innovation, and education. My name is Dirk Targoni. I'm co-organizer of SRG in Stuttgart. Today is the 4th of February, and we are streaming to you live from Stuttgart in Germany. First of all, let me quickly introduce myself. So as I said, my name is Dirk Targoni. I'm co-organizer of ISRG in Stuttgart and participating ISRG community from the beginning. I'm coming from security side and now working for automotive security. Now I'm working for Bosch as a vulnerability handler and incidents responder. Yeah, and we also have Sven. Sven, please introduce yourself.
Yeah, hello everyone. My name is Sven Schran. I'm for ASRG, the coordinator of the European continent. And in the professional life, I'm work for Robert Bosch GmbH, one of the biggest automotive supplier worldwide. And there my role is product security officer.
Thank you. Just quickly, the Automotive Security Research Group is a non-profit organization focusing on advancement of the automotive security industry. This is a community to support the coming together of two areas of competences, the IT security market and the automotive market. This is a community for you. Automotive engineers from IT security specialists like me, the beginner, the hobbyist, security researcher interesting in automotive security, even for the people that are in the wrong YouTube channel. This is also for you. This is also a community of volunteers. Our entire organization is built on the volunteer efforts of the administrative team and, of course, yourself participating in our meetings. We are trying to remove the boundaries that can occur in the automotive security industry. This could be a communication border, finding ways to learn, finding solutions, making good decisions on discussions. Because at the end of the day, we all have the same goals: to keep our customer, our families, our friends, data safe and secure. And we can achieve this together. If you want to get more involved, make an impact on the industry, start your own ISRG location, participate in the technical committees, or be a part of a project. Please reach to us. You can find more information about ISRG, our projects, our vision at www.asrg.io, or send us an email at hello@isrg.io. So, you know that ISRG is driving security innovation and making available the resources needed to ensure good security implementations. One of the most important topics during the development of ECU system or vehicle is understanding which vulnerabilities are existing. So we as a developer, tester, security researcher, hobbyist, who are members of ISRG can make sure to fix closed and solving the existing security vulnerabilities before an issue recur, or even worse, a safety issue for the people who we know occurs. And at ISRG, we start an open vulnerability management system program where we can ensure that the right people have the needed information. And therefore, we need also support for from your side. And we have a cooperation with our partner Cybellum, and to be able to understand what do you need before we are starting project, we would to understand what do you need, what do you want, what which experience did you collect until now, and therefore we are asking you to help us with the survey. You can see on the screen the survey. Please participate on it, and on the end we are going to start such a program for disclosing of vulnerabilities. So now some words about ISRG community. We started in end of summer 2017 with very few members, and right now February 2021 we have more than 6,100 members. We also have 38 locations worldwide and in 20 countries. This is a huge development, and of course this is only possible because you have an interest and you participating on supporting us. But if you see that, if you are in the location where we don't have any chapter, please reach us via email, and if you want, you can start your own chapter in your own location. Probably you will surprise how many people interesting for such topics like security and automotive. And this community help us to learn together and have a connections with each other. So today is 4th of February, and this is a weekly workshop here, and we plan also the next workshops. On February 16th, we have a meeting, we have a workshop, Speeding Up Vehicle Vulnerability Management with Context-Based Analysis. This is will be done by our cooperation partner Cybellum. The meeting after next is February 18th with the topic Voting Trust, Real World Attacks from release. And two guys, one of them I know personally, and this is very, they doing a very exciting topics. For February 23rd, we are finalize the topic, but we have our presenter and company who would like to make a presentation to us. February 25th, we have a topic, Redefining Cybersecurity for the Third Screen, From Safety to Privacy. On March 4th, 2021, we have topic Attacking SOCs by Side Channel or Laser Fault Injection. a grass squeezed. So, but if you think this is our cool topics, but you can present another very interesting topic, please contact us at cfp@isrg.io. So, and now I would like to present, to introduce to you our presenter for today. This is Dr. Thomas Pöppelmann, and he will explain us a very exciting topic, post-quantum cryptography, standardization, and an automotive case study. Welcome, Thomas.
So, yeah, thanks a lot for the introduction. As introduced, my talk will be on post-quantum cryptography and especially standardization and also automotive-related aspects. Questions I would like to try to answer is first, what is this post-quantum cryptography and maybe what is pre-quantum cryptography? Then I would like to show why this is a topic that is now getting more and more relevant for the automotive security community.
John, you have to unmute, I think.
And I would like to show where you can find further information on PQC. So if you have specific questions or if you want to do your own research, then you can use these resources to find more information. And I would like to give information on the status of post-quantum standardization. Post-quantum cryptography is currently in a standardization process relatively far, and there are also some updates that might be interesting. And then, of course, I will also introduce some of the challenges that we will be facing with PQC. And in the second half of my talk, I would like to show a case study where we have implemented post-quantum cryptography on an automotive microcontroller to give a bit of a feeling what it means to really implement a complex protocol on an automotive microcontroller device. So now the first question is, okay, quantum computers, is this really something that is that can be a threat? Isn't this science fiction? And for a long time, this really seemed to be science fiction, but nowadays we are seeing more and more investments into quantum technology and also a lot of progress. Why is this progress being made? This progress or these investments are made because we believe that with quantum computers, we would be able to compute or to solve problems in AI, chemical simulation, optimization, and cryptography that we cannot really solve with classical computers. And in addition, we see a lot of updates on the technology side. So IBM has updated their technology roadmap for quantum technology, and they are targeting a 1,000 plus qubit device in 2023. And now the question is, what is a qubit? So a qubit is kind of the smallest measure of information in a quantum computer. In a normal computer, we have bits. They are stored in registers, maybe in RAM. And in a quantum computer, we have these qubits that have these special quantum properties. And at the moment, most computers have something in the range of 20 to 40 to 50 qubits. There are also announcements of some startups like IonQ that announced a machine with 32 connected qubits that can be accessed from the cloud. And there's also an announcement by Honeywell on quantum activities. And 32 qubits to 40 qubits, this is something that can still be simulated with a classical computer. So the quantum computer doesn't really provide a big computational advantage, but it shows that the technology works and that these quantum effects can really be used. And with a 1,000 qubit machine, we would really be able to do substantial computation on the quantum computer. There's currently also a lot of funding that is going into this. The EU has set up a 1 billion quantum technology flagship. In Germany, there's also a 650 million quantum initiative, and the market for quantum hardware is estimated to be 6.2 billion in 2025. And now the big question is, why is this really an issue for cryptography? And it is an issue because of two very important algorithms. One algorithm is Shor's algorithm, and Shor's algorithm can be used on a quantum computer to solve the elliptic curve, to solve the discrete logarithm problem, or to solve the factoring problem. And therefore, it would break RSA or ECC. So when looking today into an elliptic curve with a length of 256 bit, then this elliptic curve has a security level of 128 bits, because we know that the best attacks are this complex. However, in the quantum world, this ECC, this elliptic curve with 256 bit, only has almost 0 bits of security because it can be attacked by Shor's algorithm. Shor's algorithm is a polynomial time algorithm, so we cannot really escape this attack by just increasing the length of the elliptic curve. This will not work. This will not give a substantial security adder. And then we also have another algorithm, which is called Grover's algorithm, and this can be used to attack symmetric cryptography. So today we have an AES with a 128-bit key length, then this AES has 128 bits of security. But in a quantum world, Grover's algorithm could be used to kind of perform a brute force attack onto this algorithm, onto AES on a quantum computer, and the bit level security or the complexity would be roughly 64 bit. And this is still something. It would certainly be very complex to compute this large number of computations on a quantum computer, but it's really getting into the range where it's uncomfortable, I would say. And as a consequence, we have some algorithms now that we currently use in a lot of devices that are heavily affected by quantum computers. And these are mainly RSA and then elliptic curve digital signature algorithm or the elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman. We have some algorithms that are affected, AES 128, triple defs, if you're still using it, that could be attacked by Grover's algorithm and that are not really providing a comfortable security margin anymore in the quantum world. And then we have algorithms that are considered safe. So this is AES-256, SHA-512, or SHA-3, because the key length is so long that even with Grover's algorithm, you cannot realistically construct an attack. And now the question is, how can we protect us? And the protection here is happening on our normal devices. So in post-quantum crypto, the attacker is in possession of a quantum computer. However, the users, they still want to be able to send a message with a smartphone, with a laptop. And at the moment, we cannot use quantum technology. So there are approaches that use quantum technology to encrypt communication, but these approaches are at the moment too expensive, too complicated. So with PQC, we aim to replace currently used cryptography by cryptography that is secured against attacks by quantum computers. And when going a bit more into detail here, then it's very important to make this distinction between post-quantum cryptography and quantum cryptography. In post-quantum cryptography, we are looking for new mathematical problems that are believed to be hard for a quantum computer and for a classical computer. As a replacement for something like the factoring problem, which is hard for a classical computer, but which is not so hard for a quantum computer. And then this runs post-quantum cryptography, it runs on a classical computer. We don't really need a quantum computer here. We may need a quantum computer to test out attacks, but we can also do this to some extent theoretically. And this really gained a lot of traction in around 2015, because there the NSA announced that in the foreseeable future, they would start a transition, or they would perform a transition towards post-quantum cryptography. And also NIST has started now a standardization process. On the other side, we have quantum cryptography. And when talking about quantum cryptography, this is mainly quantum key distribution. So an approach where a secure communication channel is established and it's protected by exploiting some properties of quantum mechanics that allows to detect that there's somebody tapping this communication channel. So an eavesdropper on this communication channel would disturb certain properties of the information sent, of usually photons that are sent over this communication channel. This can be detected, and this is the basis for quantum key distribution or quantum cryptography. However, this relies on quantum mechanics, and not a computational assumption, which is of course an advantage, but it has the big disadvantage that it requires a physical connection, or at least some optical connection. So you can do quantum key distribution over satellites, or you can do it over a fiber optical cable, but it's very tricky to do this as we know it today with smartphones, basically from anywhere of the world, because you're not always having a fiber optical cable to your communication partner or a direct line of sight to a satellite. And as a consequence, at Infineon, we are pursuing active research on post-quantum cryptography, because this seems to be the replacement technology that is feasible to achieve and to implement on currently available microcontrollers or computing systems. And now the question is, okay, 10 to 15, maybe 20 years, 1,000 qubit is not enough to break ECC. You would need much more, and you would also need much more stable qubits. At the moment, the qubits in the current quantum computers lose their quantum property relatively quickly, so they cannot be used at the moment for attacks. However, when looking into devices, then we can also see that we have a lot of devices that have a very long lifetime. So for example, a passport is valid for about 10 years. And this means that that it also has to be secure for the whole lifetime. And then, of course, there's also an additional time that has to be, that is needed to implement changes to the system. So if we have a passport that is available, that is valid for 10 years, we also have to account for the time that we now would need to implement post-quantum crypto or any quantum secure scheme on this. And then once we have it, the last passport will still be there for 10 years. For cars, we also have 15 years of average lifetime. This is quite long, and this could mean that that cars that are built now will still be operational when a quantum computer could be available. And in addition, we have components that are in the field for maybe 20 to 30 years in an industrial automation or in other cases where we want protection for a really long time, and where we probably have to consider post-quantum cryptography already, or at least think about implementing it. And as I've said, cars are certainly an important use case for post-quantum cryptography, especially because the cars are getting more and more connected. So they are now very complex systems with communication channels and attack vectors that are increasingly connected. And I think this is clear to all the viewers of this of the channel and of these talks. Cars are now talking to the cloud, cars are now talking to the infrastructure, and all of these communication channels have to be protected. Usually, we have a lot of secure channels, I would call this. So this is communication, for example, car to cloud, where you want to establish a secure channel and protect the authenticity and the confidentiality of the data that is maybe exchanged between the car and the OEM. And we have to consider that attackers, if this information is really something that they think is useful, might also start to store this information now, and could then try in maybe 15 to 20 years to decrypt it with a quantum computer. So this is a risk if confidentiality is involved, and if confidentiality for long term is required, then there's always the attack vector that attackers store data now and then decrypt it later. And in addition to that, we have the car-to-car or car-to-infrastructure communication. I would say this is mainly authenticity of the information. So you need PKIs and you need signatures, and you probably need a lot of them. And this requires a standardized and also a secured public key infrastructure. So yeah, in card-to-card, card-to-infrastructure, we have these PKI signatures. Card-to-cloud, we have a secure channel and especially a need for confidentiality. And now the question is, what is the status of the standardization? And there we are now quite far. So the standardization process was started by NIST in December 2017, and it was started as an open process with a call for participation that was addressed to academic researchers, to industry, to government agencies, and NIST asked for submissions of key encapsulation mechanisms or public key encryption schemes. Key encapsulation mechanism can easily be turned into a public key encryption scheme. these are mainly used to achieve confidentiality. And then NIST also asked for digital signature schemes, and they received about 69 submissions that entered the first round in December. And now in 2021, we are in round three of the NIST process, and NIST announced that in this round, round three, they have 17 candidates for public key encryption and key establishment, and they now have 9 candidates for in round two, they announced that they have 9 candidates, and now round three, they have only 15 schemes left. And then when looking into the challenges that arise here, then we have the challenge that we have a lot of different schemes that are in the NIST process. So we have the issue of diversity from 69 schemes to 25 to 15 schemes. This is still a lot of capacity that is required from academic researchers to look into these different schemes. The number of submissions is large, and the time and the resources of academic and industrial researchers or governmental researchers is certainly limited. Then there's the topic of analysis. So a selection criteria is needed. How to make the selection criteria transparent, how to establish trust that the selection that is made in the standardization process is sound. And then, of course, it's also necessary to set incentives for attackers or for cryptanalysts to check the security level of certain schemes, to check that these schemes really hold up against quantum and classical computers. And then there are a lot of questions that are currently asked about usability and flexibility and the ease of use. So how suitable is the scheme for the transition? Is it easy to replace an existing scheme by a new one, or are there properties that are not really really acceptable? And there are also two recent papers by Dan Bernstein that deal with this. So in one paper, he surveys cryptographic competitions, and in the other paper, he provides also kind of a discretization attack. So this is an attack that an imaginary attacker could perform onto the standardization process, where he wants to showcase how such a process could be manipulated and what is required to make it fair and transparent. And at the moment, this is the current status of the standardization process. So in PQC, we have about 5 families of schemes. We have lattice-based schemes, we have code-based schemes, we have multivariate quadratic-based schemes, and then we have schemes that are based on symmetric or hash functions, and we have isogenies. And we have also these two tracks. So we have the public key encryption schemes, and we have the signature scheme track, and then we have something that I would call a hash-based signature fast track, and I will talk about this a bit later. And what did NIST do in the third round? So they selected some schemes that are marked as finalist schemes. So these finalist schemes here are bold. This is a scheme called Kyber, Saber, and True, Classic Macaulay's, the Rainbow Signature, and then Delisium and Falcon. And there NIST stated that these are schemes that are really promising and that are ready for standardization after the end of round three. What NIST also announced is that they have alternate candidates, and these alternate candidates, they are regarded as very promising, but as not ready yet for standardization, or more as a backup solution that is still interesting, that should be analyzed by the academic community, but schemes that might not get immediately into a standard after round three. What NIST also stated is that these lattice-based schemes are quite similar, so the plan is to pick only one of them, because there's not much advantage by picking a large number of lattice-based schemes. It's sufficient to pick the best out of them. And in this fast track, NIST already standardized two schemes. So there's also already a NIST special publication 800-208 about the schemes, about the extendable Merkle signature scheme and the latent Mikali signature scheme. And these are stateful hash-based signatures. And the interesting property is the statefulness, because it means that when you do a signature, or when you generate a signature, you have to update the private key. And this is the stateful property. And the amount of signatures that you can generate is also limited. So at some point in time with XMSS or LMS, depending on the parameterization, the number of available signatures will kind of run out, and you cannot use the private key anymore. And you also have to be very careful when you backup this private key, because if you do a, if you put the backup into the system again, then you might have a rollback and you might use parts of the secret key that are already burned and that you should not use, and risk a security compromise by this. So now the question is, okay, what is the most suitable here, and how to make a choice, and how do these different schemes relate to each other? And there, I think it has a lot to do with the personal opinion, because I worked a lot on lattice-based schemes, and I'm trying to provide some pros and cons, but of course this might look different when you ask another researcher or another person involved with the standardization. But I'm just trying to give you a personal opinion, what are the pros and the cons, and but don't take this as the final answer of the community. So a pro of the lattice-based schemes is that some of these schemes are quite well established. So ENTRU was already proposed in 1996. And in general, with lattice-based schemes, you get really good performance, you get reasonable key ciphertext and signature sizes, at least with Kyber, Saber, ENTRU, ENTRU Prime. Delisium and Falcon Frodo is a bit special, of about 1 to 4 kilobytes. And you use similar structures to construct these chems and these signature schemes. So you can reuse some of the code, or at least some of the knowledge. But on the other hand, the security of these lattice schemes and of the structured lattice schemes, and to some extent also of the unstructured lattice schemes, is not yet fully understood. So it might take also a bit of time, more time, to really see how secure are these, how to estimate the security level. But so far, quite promising. And I think this is also the reason why so many lattice-based schemes made it into the final round, or into round three. Then we have code-based schemes. So code-based schemes are very old, which is a good thing in cryptography, because this means they are usually also well analyzed. So the Macaulay scheme was already proposed in 1978, and it's considered to be very well analyzed. The schemes are usually quite fast, and they have very short ciphertext. But they have a big disadvantage. And the big disadvantage of Macaulay's is that the public key is in the range of 0.25 to 1.3 megabytes. And this is correct. This is megabytes. So this is really, really, this has really, really big public keys. And in some applications, this might be very tricky to accommodate. And then the security of some of the structured code-based schemes, Spike, HQC, this is also not yet fully understood, because here in the cryptographic setting, structure is usually not good, because structure helps us to make more efficient schemes. But this structure might also be something that an attacker could analyze. So in general, it's good to have a scheme that is unstructured, because there is nothing to really take advantage of. Then we have these multivariate quadratic-based schemes. They have very short signatures. Rainbow has extremely short signatures with only a few bytes. Very fast signing and verification. However, also there, the public keys are quite large. So for Rainbow, it can also go into megabytes, depending on the parameter sets. And there were also some recent attacks, only a few months old, that kind of decreased the level of trust a bit, because it's, of course, a certain issue if new attacks are now coming up in this phase relatively late during the standardization. These symmetric and hash-based signature schemes, they are considered to be very well understood. However, signatures are just larger than lattices or MQ-based schemes. And this PICNIC scheme, this is also something that is relatively new. So it's a new idea, very interesting, but maybe because of this, also not yet ready for standardization. And then there's one scheme that is based on isogenies. And this is interesting because it's closely related, or related to some extent, to elliptic curves. And this might be an advantage, because then we could be able to reuse some of the hardware maybe that we already have for elliptic curves, or we could reuse some of the expertise. So knowledge on elliptic curves is not completely not completely useless in the quantum world, because isogeny-based crypto systems are quite similar. But then downside of isogenies, and maybe also the reason why they are not a finalist scheme, they might need more cryptanalysis. So the approach is also not that old. and you have very expensive computation. At least compared to lattices, you have to do more computation to compute a CAM. And now the question is there other input from standardization bodies? Yes, it is. So there have already been statements by the NSA and the German Federal Agency for Information Security. The NSA is recommending all lattice-based schemes, and the NSA is recommending these NIST, these already standardized hash-based, stateful hash-based signatures, XMSS and LMS. The BSI is also recommending schemes for high security applications, so probably governmental communication that has to stay confidential for a very long time. And there the BSI is recommending the classic Mac-ELE scheme and the FrodoCam scheme. So in the NIST competition, FrodoCam is not in the finalist category, but the BSI states that this scheme is more conservative, it's considered more secure, especially it has less structure than some of the schemes. So this is a recommendation by the BSI to go for FrodoCam for very high security use cases. And then there are also some events in the NIST standardization process that might be of interest. The NIST standardization process is an open process, and there's also an email list that is the main way to communicate by NIST to the community, and it also allows the community to ask questions. So if you want to get involved and if you want to get a bit more into the details of the standardization process, then you can sign up for the NIST email list, or you can even address questions there. And you have a lot of experts that are certainly happy to answer. And what Dan Bernstein is raising there is the question about the side channel protection of these schemes. So what he's writing is, fundamentally, what we want to know is the trade-off available between performance and security. Side channel protections add several new dimensions to the performance analysis. I think there's a fairly obvious candidate for the level of side channel protection, namely threshold implementation. So he's talking about the protection of these schemes against physical attacks. So attackers who try to extract a secret key using lasers, using power analysis measurements. And these new post-quantum schemes, of course, also have to protect it against these classical side channel attacks. And the community is currently working on this, but it's very hard because it's another metric that has to be used to compare. Then there's also something on the attack side. So the question on the diversity of signature schemes, what was written by NIST a few weeks ago is NIST notes that in the third round, there are three signature finalists and three signature alternates. Recent cryptanalysis has impacted the analysis of both Rainbow and GMSS. We are concerned about a lack of diversity of signature schemes for security and application reason. So what NIST is stating here, okay, we only have very few signature schemes, and there was a recent attack that reduced the security level of Rainbow and GMSS a bit. So people might now be a bit concerned that there are further attacks, that these attacks can be extended. And then basically NIST is only left with the lattice-based schemes and with the Sphinx Plus alternate scheme and Picnic. And so the question is now, should there be another round for signature schemes, or is there an approach to reduce the risk here? So this is a very dynamic process because, of course, NIST cannot anticipate new attacks. We all hope that these schemes are secure, but now that there's a limited amount of schemes in the final round, attackers will certainly focus their effort on these schemes, and we might see new attacks there. There's no security proof or good argument that these schemes are ultimately secure. And then there's also a conference that is upcoming. So there's the third NIST PQC conference. The call for papers has been published recently, and NIST will plan this conference as a virtual conference. And I think this is a very good opportunity to get deeper into the topic of PQC, and maybe to also ask questions to NIST and to all the various submitters of cryptographic schemes. And now talking about some of the challenges. Of course, there's the challenge of implementing these new schemes on various devices, and it really depends what scheme we are implementing where. So some of these schemes, if we implement them on a normal computer, it doesn't really matter that much. We probably can even live with the 1.5 megabyte public key if we do email encryption. because we can just handle that. On the other hand, if we're looking into embedded devices, especially into microcontrollers, then this might be quite tricky because a microcontroller might not even have 1.5 megabyte of non-volatile memory to be able to store one public key, and transmission of the public key over a bus system might also be very slow. And therefore, it really depends. A lot of work of the community is now targeted towards optimizing these schemes on various platforms and to also provide measurements of the performance of these schemes. And there are very good sources available now. So there are four projects that I would like to highlight that have further information. So there's the Open Quantum Safe project, which provides an integration of various PQC schemes into transport layer security, TLS. There's the SuperCOP benchmarking framework that performs a lot of benchmarks of PQC on Intel CPUs, on AMD CPUs, and on the more powerful ARM CPUs. And there's the MooPQ project, which is providing implementations of PQC on the Cortex-M4. I think they also added now implementations on the Cortex-M3, and they are also looking into the RISC-V microcontroller architectures. And then there's the Pico Crypto Lounge, and this Pico Crypto Lounge provides searchable data on the submissions and gives you easy access to some of the ciphertext sizes and other data. And to get a bit more into this complexity, how to evaluate a scheme, I've listed some of the results from the PQM4 project here. So I've listed Kyber, Saber, these are two finalist schemes, and then Frodo and Psyche, these are alternate scheme, and also an implementation of elliptic curve of curve 25519, all on a Cortex-M4 microcontroller. And when looking into the properties here, then you can see that also the sizes of public keys and ciphertext really differ. With elliptic curves, we had a very, very nice situation, very short public keys, very short ciphertext, only 64 bytes. But with Psyche, Frodo, Saber, this goes up. And ciphertext for Saber and Kyber is equally 1,880 byte. The Frodo scheme, which is recommended by the BSI, has a larger ciphertext, about 9,000 byte. And regarding cycles here, some of the schemes are very similar, and this is probably the reason why NIST only wants to pick one. So the cycle counts for Kyber and Saber are really similar, and it's quite fast. It's even faster than ECC. So key generation, only 900,000 cycles. Encryption, about a million cycles, and decryption is also about a million cycles. So this is even faster than elliptic curves. It's not true to say that these new post-quantum schemes, that they are a lot slower than ECC. That's not the case, but certainly they have these larger structures and they also consume a bit more memory. And on the other hand here, if we want to obtain these short ciphertext that the Esogeny-based scheme offers, then we have to live with the slower computation. So if we want these short ciphertext, then we are talking about encryption and decryption, about 78 to 84 million cycles. What's also very interesting is that a lot of the time in some of these lattice-based schemes is spent on hashing. So the schemes are now so optimized that for Kyber, we have 64 to 81% of the cycles just attributed to SHA-3. And this is quite interesting because it also means that this offers an opportunity for optimization, because if you have a fast SHA-3 or maybe a SHA-3 in hardware, then you can also accelerate Kyber here. As I've said, the memory consumption also goes up. This depends, of course, also on the implementation and the optimization levels. So it's in the range of 3 to 20 kilobytes for the CAMs. For the signature schemes, it's a bit different. And then we also have the challenge, of course, reuse and agility. Because at the moment, we have RSA and ECC almost everywhere. We have made a big investment into hardware accelerators. But on the other hand, we need a replacement of these cryptographic algorithms in the future. And maybe we also want to ship devices today and then upgrade the cryptography later just using software updates. And we also need to find ways to integrate these new cryptographic primitives into old protocols, or maybe use old protocols and new protocols in parallel. And one interesting aspect that can be used, or one interesting property that can be used, is an RSA coprocessor, for example. So this was a work that we've presented 2 years ago. And what we exploit is, if you have RSA, you do big integer multiplication. And if you have a hardware accelerator, for example, on a chip card that is able to do this big integer multiplication, then you kind of can misuse it to do lattice-based post-quantum cryptography. And the idea is, okay, on this RSA coprocessor, basically you have a system that can do a multiplication or an addition of two numbers, modulus, and here this X, Y, and Z, they are of size 2,200 bits. And in a software implementation, this would be rather slow, but with this hardware coprocessor, we can achieve a speed of about a factor of two. And we are doing this using a technique, for example, that is called Kronecker substitution. So in lattice-based crypto, we are concerned a lot with polynomial multiplication. Here's a very simple example of a polynomial multiplication. And the trick that we are exploiting is that you can also represent this polynomial as a big integer. So if you evaluate it at a certain value, here it's 100. And there's one error on it on the slide. So evaluate A and B at 100, you get the values 203, 101, and then you do a big integer multiplication. And in the end, if the sizes are good, and if you don't have overflows, this again becomes a polynomial, or can be turned into a polynomial. And with this, we use basically an RSA coprocessor to accelerate post-quantum cryptography. And I think this is an interesting avenue for research, to see how can we use old hardware or hardware that is already there and make the transition towards post-quantum cryptography a bit easier. And what I would now like to talk about is an automotive use case. As I've said, the car is becoming more and more connected. There are more and more features where the car is communicating. And I think we have always this problem that we want to establish a secure channel between different devices. And we have published a paper that was presented at ESCA 2020, which is called Quantum Safe Authenticated Key Exchange Protocol for Automotive Application. This is joint work with Julius Hermeling, Mark Stöttinger, Yi Wang, and Yong Wan, from University of the Bundeswehr and Continental. And what we did there is we implemented a post-quantum key exchange protocol on the Aurix microcontroller. So the Infineon Aurix microcontroller is used in a lot of different automotive applications, for example, for motor control, but also as a gateway. And what we wanted to show here is, how do these different schemes work in a more complex protocol? Because it's usually not enough to just have a key encapsulation mechanism or to have a signature scheme, because what you really want is to establish a secure channel. And with this work, we also want to stimulate some discussion. This is certainly not the final answer, and it also shows that this is research, because we used a scheme called New Hope for our experiments, and we started when NIST was still in round two. But then in round three, New Hope was eliminated because it's very similar to other lattice-based schemes. And it doesn't mean that the research now is completely invalid, but it is. I think it shows that some of this research is, of course, a bit risky, because we don't know how the standardization process really will go in the future. The implementations may also be improved. There are also different instantiations possible, but we wanted to show what happens if you try to instantiate something on a microcontroller, and also what the parameters are there. And what we are concerned with is this handshake, so this process of checking the identity of two parties, of Alice and Bob, and then to establish a secure key between them. So really replace the crypto operations that RSA or ECC would do. We haven't really looked into the data transfer afterwards. Our goal here is to exchange a secret key that can then be used for bulk data transfer. And of course, this can always be the communication between a car and the cloud, or it could also be the communication between a car and another car. This, I think it's a universal primitive to have a secure channel between two entities. And now the question is, okay, why is this really a problem? Why don't you just take some PQC schemes and then you're done? And the reason why it's not so easy is, of course, these schemes have different properties. So you could end up with a very, very with a very expensive protocol. For example, if you use classic Mac-ELEs and you have 1.3 megabyte large public keys, then this might be quite tricky on a microcontroller, because where do you store these keys? Can you really transfer these keys? This we have to deal with. Then we also have to deal with the case that some of the signature schemes are rather slow, or at the moment they seem to be slower than the CAMs, and they also have sometimes non-deterministic runtime, which could also be tricky. And we could also use, of course, stateful hash-based signature schemes. They are quite efficient, but there we only have a limited number of signatures per private key. So some of these constraints have to be taken into account. And what we implemented is a three-pass authenticated key exchange protocol that also supports forward secrecy. So I would say it has all the properties that you would want from a key exchange protocol. And for this, we use a paper by St. Guillaume, Smart, and Vashini, where they proposed this protocol in a generic way. And what we do in this work, we instantiate it with concrete primitives from the NIST process. And it's very similar to another work that has been published by Schwabes, Stibilia, and Vigas, which is post-quantum TLS without handshake signatures. So they are also going down this road of eliminating active signing in the crypto protocol for better performance. And why am I a bit reluctant to introduce a signature scheme here into the protocol? One reason is, for example, that the Delisium signature scheme has non-deterministic runtime. So a lot of the cycle counts that you will see for Delisium, they are average runtimes. And the case is, or the reason is that the Delisium scheme, it has four basic steps. So it prepares the data structures, it hashes a message, and then it draws a random value, and it attempts to generate a signature using this randomness, and it performs a test on the signature. And if the test is saying okay, then the signature is output. But if the signature is not okay, then you just try again with a different random value. And this means for about 100 runs in this PQM4, you get an average timing of 6.4 million cycles on a Cortex-M4. But on the other hand, you have also a maximum number of cycles of 23 million. And this is something that could be, in a safety critical implementation, quite critical, because you cannot count on the signature signing or on the signature generation time, because if these tests are not successful for a long time, then the signing time goes up quite a lot. And there's another competitor, Falcon, which is also lattice-based schemes. This one is deterministic, but on the other hand, it requires about 85 million cycles on a Cortex-M4 microcontroller to perform a signature operation. And this may really lead to bad user experience. So what we did here is we used a New Hope, and we used two variants of this New Hope scheme. New Hope is a CAM scheme that was submitted to the NIST process. It's very similar to the schemes Kyber, Saber, uses Ring LWE as a basic security foundation. And it also has very similar efficiency parameters. And what we have implemented here is a protocol where each user holds a static public and a static private key pair that is used to authenticate to authenticate the user in the end. And we also have a public key that is part of a certificate. And this certificate is signed by XMSS. So we use a certificate chain, or we don't use a certificate. We only have single certificates that are issued by a PKI. And these certificates are protected by XMSS. The rationale for this is that, of course, the statefulness of the XMSS scheme could be a problem. As I've said, if you do a backup, if you put the backup into place again, and if you overwrite some of the state, this could be an issue. But for a PKI, the certificates are issued by a certificate agency that can deal with this backup issues and that can ensure that the secret, that the state of the public, of the private key is updated correctly. And we assume that these that the certificate agency's public key is deployed before the protocol is executed. And then we also have forward secrecy. So for forward secrecy, we use New Hope in a different variant. So New Hope has two variants, a chosen plaintext attack secure variant and a chosen ciphertext attack secure variant. And the CCA secure variant is a bit more complex. So for an ephemeral key exchange, we use New Hope CPA. And the approach that is happening is that, or the protocol that is executed is that we exchange these XMSS signed certificate that contain a New Hope public key. There we have the XMSS verification. And then each party generates an ephemeral key. So we generate an ephemeral New Hope key pair, and this ephemeral New Hope key pair is encrypted with the public key, with the long-term public key of the party V. So only the party V is able to decrypt the ephemeral key. This is sent over to the party V. Party V can decrypt this message because only party V is in possession of the secret key that corresponds to the public key that has been authenticated by the certificate. And then V encapsulates another message with the public, with the long-term public key of U, sends this over, and U decrypts this message with a long-term secret key and decapsulates the session key with the ephemeral secret key and obtains therefore a session key and sends again a final message, final confirmation message back to party V, so that we can also run a key key derivation function here. This is a rather complex protocol, but to achieve forward secrecy, this ephemeral key generation procedure is required. And of course, we need the usual exchange of certificates, and we need long-term public keys to achieve security. And when looking into the implementation, then you can see that by introducing post-quantum crypto, we are not only looking into the specific times of each algorithm, but we have to look into the overall complexity of the exchange. And on the Infineon Aurex microcontroller, which is running at 300 megahertz, we have about 20 million cycles that are attributed to the verification of the certificates. And then the different steps are taking about 7 million cycles, 12 million, 4.8 million cycles, and then the final step is rather fast. But in the end, we have about 30 million cycles to execute this key exchange, and we also have to exchange quite a lot of information. So the certificates are already 4,500 bytes long, and then the messages are about 4,000, 6,000 bytes. So this is quite complicated and complex, but this is also what you should expect, in my opinion, when implementing post-quantum cryptography, for example, for a secure channel establishment in automotive. And what does this show? It shows that PQC can be implemented on the Aurex. It's not something that is so complicated and so complex that it will never run on an automotive microcontroller. But it also shows that we have to take care with the schemes that we pick. We have to take care with the data that we have to send out. And we also have some of these limitations, for example, with XMSS, which seems to work fine here for a certificate agency or for certificates, but where we really have to take care due to the statefulness property. This CHEM approach works quite well. Probably it doesn't really matter if you use Kyber or Saber as a replacement for New Hope, but then other schemes could not be so suitable because key generation might be slower. For example, the Entru scheme or some variants of the Andrew scheme have very slow key generation, so they might not be suitable for this ephemeral key generation. And then if you would switch to classic Mac-Elise, of course, public keys would probably be way too large to be used. There's also some potential for tuning. You could still optimize this using assembly implementations. It might also be possible to optimize further using exploiting the cache architecture and the memory architecture. And there's also some work that implements a slightly faster New Hope version on the Aurix from 2019. But in the end, I think we can show that that such a complex protocol can be implemented, and you have kind of an upper boundary on the complexity. Certainly, we can still optimize here and there, but I would guess that the amount of data that has to be exchanged is not really going down by much. And this amount of data can especially be an issue if you send this over a slower connection. So for example, if you send the messages M1, M2, and M3, these are about 82,000 bits. If you send them over a CAN communication with 500 kilobits per second, then this already takes 165 milliseconds. And this is about equivalent to 50 million cycles on the Aurix. So it really shows that cycle counts in post-quantum is one thing, but the other probably more important thing is the amount of cycles or time that you spend on transferring data between two parties. And if your communication line is slow, it could be impacted by the introduction of PQC. What's also nice is now with Nistron 3, of course, we have fewer schemes that we have to look into. So it's much easier to make a choice. And I would guess that a lot of next steps are really the integration of these new schemes into different application domains, into TLS, into payment, into passports, and also into automotive applications or into automotive specific protocols. And there, this primitive from the NIST process really has to match the requirements of the protocol and the operating conditions. And I think NIST really appreciates feedback. So if the automotive security community has feedbacks on the selection of these schemes, I think it would be very valuable to provide this feedback to NIST to give them some guidance what schemes are suitable and should be standardized. What may also help already that can we see from these implementations is they are very heavy on SHA-256 if you use XMSS with this scheme. And they also make heavy usage of SHA-3. And so Kyber, New Hope, or Saber, they may really benefit from a hardware-based SHA-3 accelerator, for example, in an automotive controller or in other microcontrollers, to speed up all the hashing operations that have to be performed inside of these schemes. And sometimes it may also be possible to use AES as a pseudo-random number generator. And now I'm coming close to the conclusion of my call and also call to action. So my point would be post-quantum cryptography is something that is certainly needed to secure the quantum computer world. It will not go away. There's a lot of progress currently happening in the construction of quantum computers. And my recommendation there is watch the standardization process, also watch other standardization bodies and what they are doing, monitor research projects and the research on post-quantum cryptography. And I think this is the most important thing, conduct first experiments and also provide feedback to the standardization bodies, because now there's still time to set the right directions. And this can only be done if there are experiments that provide data how to continue. And then, of course, it's necessary to prepare for this transition. Quantum safe or post-quantum cryptography will not be something that is there just with a finger snip. Today we are pre-quantum, tomorrow we only have PQC. It will be really a long process where a lot of protocols will run in parallel, of course, and where we need to do a migration and where we probably need a lot of cryptographic agility. So protocols, devices, software that can deal with various cryptographic primitives and protocols and that can also be updated to new schemes to increase the security level. And with this, I'm done with my presentation. I hope that that it was interesting, and I'm happy to answer questions.
Thank you, Thomas, for the very interesting topic. So I have one question. What are currently open challenges?
As I said, a lot of open challenges. So the open challenges, of course, really depend on your point of view. So there are a lot of these open challenges from the point of the standardization. So which scheme to pick, which scheme is the right one. And there are these challenges from a more practical point of view. I think the biggest challenge is to estimate what will happen if I have to introduce post-quantum cryptography into a secure system, into a legacy system or into a new system. Is it possible to support PQC, for example, on microcontrollers due to the need for more for larger public keys? And I think, yeah, the biggest challenge is to see what will happen and to prepare for this.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, then thank you very much for your talk. I don't see currently any other questions from our audience. And yeah, I really appreciate your work, your presentation, and yeah, see you again next time. Thanks also for all participants here, and we are very, very sorry for a technical issue that we had, and thank you that you found the new session and joined this live stream. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks a lot.